Welcome to VGuy TV. In this video, I'm giving a quick revision on chapter System of Particles and Rotatory Motion. System of Particles and Rotatory Motion. First, I'm going to discuss center of mass. Center of mass means the entire mass of the system is concentrated at a point, or it is the point where the entire mass of the body is assumed to be concentrated. That point is called center of mass. Let few bodies of masses m1, m2, m3 are located at a distance of x1, x2, x3. Then I can find the center of mass by using the formula m1 x1 plus m2 x2 plus etc. up to mn xn by m1 plus m2 plus etc. up to mn. This equation I can use. But in few questions, some days they'll give in the form of position vector. Position vector means r1 they will give in the form of xi plus yj plus zk. Like in the vector form, if they are given, you use the equation RCM is m1 r1 plus m2 r2 plus etc. up to mn rn by m1 plus m2 etc. up to mn. But if it is not like this masses and all, like m1 and m2 m3 form, you can use like extended body means you use the formula XCM as integral of XDM divided by integral of DM. Integral of XDM by integral of DM for continuous bodies. It means for extended bodies. It means they are not given like a uniform distribution of the mass. The mass is changing with respect to length. Those situation we should write integral of XDM by integral of DM. Right? This equations you can even convert in terms of velocity center of mass and acceleration center of mass. Velocity center of mass is m1 v1 plus m2 v2 plus etc. up to mn vn by m1 plus m2 plus etc. up to mn. If you want acceleration, m1 a1 plus m2 a2 plus etc. up to mn an by m1 plus m2 plus etc. up to mn. So in short, we can find the position vector center of mass, or we can find the velocity center of mass, or we can find the acceleration center of mass like a similar equations. With the similar equations, we can find the center of mass of all three physical quantities. Now, I'm going to give examples of few center of mass. For a rectangular plane, the center of mass lies at the geometric center, that means intersection of diagonals. For a square, that also center of mass lies at geometric center, means intersection of diagonals. For a triangle, it is intersection of median, it is called centroid. Center of mass located at centroid. But if you take a uniform semicircular ring, its center of mass located at a distance h equals 2r by pi from center. That means from this point you are taken, this point to this will be the distance h. So we are taking the distance from center. If it's a uniform circular disk, its center of mass h equals 4r by 3 pi. If it's a hemispherical shell, h equals r by 2. If it's a solid sphere, h equals 3r by 8. If it is an arc, it is h equals r sine theta by theta, where the arc subtending an angle of 2 theta. R sine theta by theta for an arc. For an arc, but the arc subtending an angle of 2 theta, you remember. Instead of this arc, if it is a sector, it will be 2 by 3 r sine theta by theta. Why I told this first? Because if you check these two answers, this will be 2 by 3. The sector will be 2 by 3 of the arc. And both the cases, angle subtended is 2 theta. If it's a right circular cone, h equals 3h by 4. H equals 3h by 4. Right? If it's a solid sphere, h is equal to 3r by 8 from center. If it is a hemispherical shell, it is at a distance of h equals r by 2. So remember, I told about total. Here how many cases are there? Here total 10 cases we did. Triangle at centroid. Rectangle at geometric center. Square at geometric center. Only this type of things you have to remember. Semicircular ring is 2r by pi. Unicircular disc, semicircular disc, it is 4r by 3 pi. Next one is hemispherical shell is r by 2. Solid hemisphere is 3r by 8. And for arcs and a sector, arc is r sin theta by theta and sector is 2 by 3 r sin theta by theta. If it's a right circular cone, it is h equals 3h by 4. In this point only, your center of mass located. That all from the base we are taken. Clear? Now, see, we are talking about rotatory motion. Rotatory motion means the particle is rotating about a fixed axis. When the particle is rotating, the mass we are changing with an another analogous term called moment of inertia. So, moment of inertia is nothing but the rotatory analog of the mass, and it is denoted with the letter I, and its general formula is I equals mr square and its unit is kilogram meter square. So, moment of inertia is nothing but the rotatory analog. It means when a body is rotating, its moment of inertia changes. Because when a body is rotating, axis plays a very important role. So, to find moment of inertia, we need two theorems, that is called parallel axis theorem and perpendicular axis theorem. Parallel axis theorem means, let this be a rigid body and I naught is a moment of inertia through center of mass. Let the body is rotating about the axis AB. So, this I naught and AB are parallel. So, if you want the moment of inertia along AB, it is nothing but I naught plus mass into square of the distance between the axis. So, IAB is I naught plus MA square. This theorem is called parallel axis theorem. Moment of inertia along the axis AB is sum of moment of inertia I naught plus M into A square. A is the distance between the parallel axis. I'll discuss few questions how we can solve the questions. Perpendicular axis means we take three axes which are perpendicular, mutually perpendicular, X axis, Y axis, Z axis. So, if you want moment of inertia along Z axis, that is nothing but sum of moment of inertia along X axis and Y axis. That is Iz equal Ix plus Iy. Ix and Iy are the moment of inertia along X axis and Y axis, provided X axis, Y axis, Z axis are mutually perpendicular. Okay, so I told two theorems to calculate moment of inertia. And sometimes they will give from a whole body. For example, this is a sphere. It has a moment of inertia. We are removing another small sphere from that. So, what is the moment of inertia of the remaining body, they can ask. So, that case, moment of inertia of the remaining body is moment of inertia of the whole body minus moment of inertia of the removed portion. If you do, it will be the moment of inertia of the remaining part. If some part of the rigid body is removed from the whole body, the moment of inertia of the remaining body is I remaining is I whole minus I removed. Now, I will show you how to find the moment of inertia of bodies. One example I will show you. See, this is a bangle, right? This is a bangle. Okay, you take this as like a uniform bangle only. Okay, so this bangle I placed on this yellow color paper. So, this yellow color paper is the plane of the ring. This is called the plane of the ring, right? So, plane of the ring, I am keeping it here. I am taking one more axis. Or I am taking one more plane, that is this plane. Okay, another paper I am taking. That paper is lying perpendicular to my yellow color paper. So, this is called the plane which is perpendicular to my ring. So, two planes are there. One is the plane of the ring, other one is this plane. Okay, this blue color paper, that paper is nothing but perpendicular to my yellow color paper. Okay, so this yellow color paper is called the plane of the ring. And this blue color paper is called the plane which is perpendicular to the ring, right? Now, normally for circular ring, four axes they will tell. Very, very important, four axes we will tell. The first axis is, I am keeping it here, okay? So, the first one, so you can see that also how I have written. So, the first one is the axis which is perpendicular to the plane of the ring. And which is passing through the center. So, first axis is this one. Okay. First axis is this one. This axis means the axis This is nothing but the axis. This is the axis. And this axis is nothing but this is the axis. This axis is nothing but it is passing through the center, and also it is perpendicular to the plane of the ring. For this pen is lying perpendicular to the yellow color paper. So this is the first axis. Axis passing through center and perpendicular to the plane of the ring. So that's what I drawn it like this. So that moment of inertia is mr square. Okay, first you see only this part, mr square. Second case, they are asking for diameter. So we know that this is the diameter, right? If you want diameter, you already, I told you, this is the axis which is perpendicular, right? So that answer we got it now. So now we have two cases here. The one is the axis which is passing through the center, we know. That is the first thing, mr square. And this is nothing but the diameter, right? So what we are doing is, we can take two diameters here. So if I am taking two pens, and these two pens are perpendicular, this is a diameter, and even this also it's a diameter. Okay, both are diameters, and even this is nothing but the axis which is perpendicular. Now if you see all the three pens, you can tell that this brown, yellow and the middle pen, they all are mutually perpendicular. So we use perpendicular axis theorem to find along the diameter. So in that way, I get an equation as mr square by 2. Because for diameter, both the diameter, we are getting the same answer. So actually we are getting ix plus iy equals iz. Ix and iy are equal to 2y, I'll write. And iz is nothing but through center. Center, I got it as mr square. So what will be I in this case? I in this case is mr square by 2. So that only we are writing here, mr square by 2. So first is moment of inertia, that is passing through the moment of inertia of the ring passing through the center, this one center. Second one we did is moment of inertia along the diameter. Third one is any tangent of the plane they ask. So this is the diameter. Any tangent in the plane of the ring they ask. Any tangent in the plane of the ring means you can take this as a tangent. Right, so this is a tangent and the tangent is lying in the plane. So these two pens are coming parallel. So we can use my parallel axis theorem. When you are using parallel axis theorem, we should take diameter as one axis and the distance between these two axes as r. And in that way, mr square by 2 plus mr square, we are getting 3 by 2 mr square. Clear? Fourth one is any tangent perpendicular to the ring. Any tangent perpendicular to the ring means that tangent is nothing but this tangent. This is also a tangent. But when we are taking this tangent, definitely we have to take one axis that is passing through the center. Understood the point? If you are taking this as, this also it's a tangent. Right? When you are taking this as a tangent, another axis you have to take, axis which is passing through center, axis which is passing through center. So these two are also parallel lines. So in the last case, what we are getting is mr square plus mr square, that is nothing but 2 mr square. So remember what I told now, for a ring there are total 4 axes. This is a ring. First case is the moment of inertia passing through the center, this one, that is mr square. Second one, moment of inertia for a diameter, this one, that is mr square by 2. I use perpendicular axis theorem. Third one is, they are asking tangent in its plane. So we are taking a tangent like this. So tangent and this diameter are parallel. So we use parallel axis theorem. We got 3 by 2 mr square. Last one is tangent perpendicular to the ring. So that time we are taking the tangent is 1 inch through the center and these two tangents. These two tangents we are taking. Okay, can you see? So in that way we are taking the moment of inertia. Why I showed this? If you know how to make the axis, you can easily solve the question by using parallel axis theorem. So you have to remember all the equation. So circular ring means it is not compulsory one equation. Circular ring is rotating about which axis? Through the center mr square, through diameter mr square by 2, tangent in the plane is 3 by 2 mr square, perpendicular to the ring is 2 mr square. What I did is, these all moment of inertia we get in one more form. You equate these all moment of inertia to mk square, where k is called the radius of gyration. This is a particular distance in which we get the moment of inertia if we square that and multiply with the mass. So they may ask the radius of gyration of each question. So what you should do is, what you are getting the moment of inertia, that you equate with mk square. So if you are equating mr square with mk square, what will be k? K equal to r. Second case, if they are asking what is k means, mr square by 2 equate with mk square. So k will be r by root 2. Third case is equal to mk square means k will be root over 3 by 2 r. If you need the last one means 2 mr square means it is mk square, that will be root 2 r. In this way, ring got arranged. Same like ring, we have disc. Disc also, there are four cases. One is same like ring only. Center perpendicular to the ring, along the diameter, tangent in the plane and tangent in the perpendicular plane. So the first one is mr square by 2. Second one, we are using perpendicular axis theorem. We get half of that, mr square by 4. Then we use parallel axis theorem. That is mr square by 2 plus mr square. That is 5 by 4 mr square. And tangent perpendicular means we are using the first one plus mr square, that is 3 by 2 mr square. So you have to write like this and you should learn. In all the cases, if you need radius of gyration, equate it to mk square. Clear? Now, like that, few bodies I have written. Main thing, sphere, solid sphere, very very important question. Moment of inertia along the diameter means 2 by 5 mr square. But if they are asking the tangent, it will be 7 by 5 mr square. If it's a spherical shell, 2 by 3 mr square. Tangent means 5 by 3 mr square. Solid cylinder means we can take it as three cases. Along the axis is mr square by 2, same like a disc. Center perpendicular to the length is m into r square by 4 plus l square by 12. For n phase, if you are taking m into r square by 4 plus l square by 3. If it's a thin cylinder, on its own axis means mr square, that means nothing but the ring. If it is along the center means m into r square by 2 plus l square by 12. You can compare these all, see, so like a comparable equation. If they are asking n phase perpendicular to the length means, n phase perpendicular to the length means how we are taking like this. In that case, if it m into r square by 2 plus l square by 3, this is for a thin cylinder. Next, this also it's a very important question for exams. One dimensional rod of mass m, length l. If you're taking through the center, if this is ml square by 12. If it is for one end, it is ml square by 3. We are using parallel axis theorem. For a rectangular lamina of length l, breadth b means center of the lamina means m into l square plus b square by 12. If they are asking the center of the length and perpendicular to that means ml square by 12 plus b square by 3. If they are asking center of the breadth and perpendicular to the plane is ml square by 3 plus b square by 12. If it's a rectangular block, they can ask rectangular block, center of block, which is parallel to which one? If it is parallel to length, you write m into b square plus h square by 12. If it is parallel to breadth, you write m into h square plus l square by 12. If it is for the height, you write m into l square plus b square by 12. Next, it's for a solid uniform right cone of mass m, radius r and length. For the symmetric axis, it is 3 by 10 mr square. And if it's a thin uniform right cone, it is 1 by 2 mr square. Now, this is a very important point of this chapter. Okay, center of residual body. Okay, I already told you moment of inertia of this case. If you are removing some portion from a whole body, what happens? Same like that, this happened for your center of mass also. You have a big, you assume this is like a disc. From the disc, you are removing a small disc. So they will ask what happened for the center of mass. If it's a uniform disc, I know that center of mass is located at the center. So its center of mass for the residual body or the remaining body, I can take it as m1 x1 minus m2 x2 by m1 minus m2. In this case, this you can change as mass as density into volume. Mass I can write it as density into volume, that is density into area into thickness I can write. Density remains same, it get cancelled and it will be equal to a1 x1 minus a2 x2 by a1 minus a2. Actually, this is the equation we are using for numericals. a1 x1 minus a2 x2 by a1 minus a2. a1 is the area of the first body and x1 is the where the center of mass located. So normally that x1 we are taken as 0 because we take the distance with respect to that point only. So first term normally it will become 0 minus second term a2 is the area of the removed portion. x2 is the distance from first center of mass to the second center of mass. So that distance is your x2. So normal cases we get an answer like a minus a2 x2 by a1 minus a2. It's a very very important question I've seen in many exams. M1, A1, X1 are mass, area and distance of the whole mass before removal and M2, A2, X2 are the values of the removed portion. In this way, we can locate the center of mass. Another main question is, let a body is rolling over an inclined plane. When a body is rolling over an inclined plane, the velocity we can calculate by root over 2gh by 1 plus k square by r square, where h is the height and l is the slanting length. If you want acceleration, g sin theta by 1 plus k square by r square. If you want time, it is root over 2l by g sin theta into 1 plus k square by r square. This is also very very important. When a body is rolling over an inclined plane, what happened for the velocity, what happened for acceleration, what happened for the time. By seeing this equation, you understood that velocity is inversely proportional to root over 1 plus k square by r square. And acceleration is 1 by inversely proportional to 1 by 1 plus k square by r square. But time is directly proportional to root over 1 plus k square by r square. So k is nothing but the radius of gyration. And I told you the k changes depends upon the body and depends on the axis. The ring has K, but the ring K will change with respect to axis. So you have to take care that part. Okay, K value very very important, radius of gyration. Now I'll tell a shortcut to remember how we can change an equation. For translatory case, displacement is S, for rotation it is angular displacement theta. So left side full translatory motion, right side is rotatory motion. Linear velocity changes to angular velocity omega. Acceleration A changes to angular acceleration alpha. Mass changes to moment of inertia I. Momentum, linear momentum changes to angular momentum L. Force changes to torque tau. And you should remember V equal U plus AT. I can write omega equals omega naught plus alpha T. S equal UT plus half AT square changes to theta equal omega naught T plus half alpha T square. V square minus U square equal 2AS changes to omega square minus omega naught square equal 2 alpha into theta. These are the standard equations. And another 6 equations, 5 equation I am giving in which how to convert. You know F equal to MA. F changes to tau. M changes to I. A changes to alpha. So tau equal I alpha, where torque equal moment of inertia into angular acceleration. P equal mv changes to L equals I omega. Very important equation for solving numerical. L equals I omega. Many people will forget this equation. No problem. If you know mv, you can change the terms. Kinetic energy is P square by 2m. That you can write it as L square by 2i. Kinetic energy is half mv square. That you can change to half I omega square. Power is fv. You can write it as tau omega. Now I need to tell one more equation. Tau equal R cross F is the vector form of the torque. Angular momentum L equals R cross P is the general equation. Another one is, we can write it as A equals omega. Sorry, we can write A equals alpha cross R and V equals omega cross R. These are the 4 vector equation form in this chapter. Tau equal R cross F, tau is the torque, F is the force. L equal R cross P, L is the angular momentum, P is the linear momentum. A equal alpha cross R, A is the acceleration, linear acceleration, alpha is the angular acceleration. V is the linear velocity, omega is the angular velocity. V equals omega cross R. In this form also they can ask the questions. And remember, you should remember an equation, omega. Omega is nothing but velocity. We can write omega as 2 pi f also. In that form also they can ask. Omega is equal to 2 pi f. Also remember, f is nothing but frequency. And its unit is hertz or RPS or RPM. In that form, if you see in the question, remember it is f. Okay, omega means its unit should be equal to radian per second. Many people will get the confusion given quantities omega or f. So by seeing the unit, you can clear thing. If its unit is hertz or RPS or RPM, it is frequency. It is not omega. You have to find omega by 2 pi f. Omega unit should be radian per second. Omega unit should be radian per second. Alpha unit should be radian per second square. Now I'm telling a general motion. General motion. So see, a body is rolling. When a particle P moves in a circle of radius r with an angular velocity with respect to center of mass. That means velocity with respect to center of mass is V of particle with respect to center of mass is r omega. Just now I told an equation of same form only. VPM, that is particle with respect to center of mass is r omega. So the velocity of particle with the center of mass is velocity of particle minus velocity of center of mass. If you want velocity of particle, that is nothing but velocity of particle center of mass plus velocity of center of mass. So they gave it like this. This is the particle center of mass velocity. This is the center of mass velocity and the body is rotating. Same way, when the particle is rotating, it has angular acceleration also. So the particle here, this is acceleration center of mass. The particle is rotating. It has APCM. So the particle acceleration, if you want, acceleration of center of mass plus acceleration of particles with respect to center of mass plus AR, that means radial acceleration, if they are given, we can take it. And velocity of particle with respect to center of mass is R alpha. So why I wrote these two equations? Because you have to remember these two cases. V is equal to R omega and A is nothing but R alpha. That means the velocity of particle with respect to center of mass. Now, this is another main case. When a body is, first the body has only translatory motion, you assume. At the top, the velocity will be like this. Here also velocity is like this for a translatory motion. As the particle is moving front, the velocity center of mass also in the same direction. Second case, you take the body is rotating. When the body is rotating, at the top, the velocity will be towards the right and at the down, the velocity will be towards left. As it is rotating, the linear velocity with respect to center of mass will be zero. Third case is the particle is rolling as well as translation. So that time these two velocity, top both the right side velocity together form 2V and down 2 you see oppositely directed. So its velocity will be zero. So its velocity will be zero. So top will be 2V, down will be zero because these two are oppositely directed and center of mass will be V only. Now if you see, the kinetic energy of translatory motion is half mv square. Kinetic energy of rotatory motion will be half I omega square. And if the body has both translation and rotation, it will be half mv square into 1 plus k square by r square, where k is radius of gyration. Sometimes they will ask the ratio. Ratio of translational kinetic energy is to, ratio of rotational kinetic energy is to, ratio of total energy. So 1 is to k square by r square is to 1 plus k square by r square. Remember, I can also be written as mk square, B we can written as r omega. So half I omega square we can write it as half mk square into v square by r square. So we can write it as half mv square into k square by r square. In that form only I am getting this equation. Half mv square, if you are taken as common, half mv square into 1 plus k square by r square is the total rotational kinetic energy. Very important case. When a body is rotating and coming down, both rolling and translatory motion is there, we can find here half into half mv square into 1 plus k square by r square. Now the last case is, you see, the toppling cases also questions can come. Like this is a body lying in a plane and the body of mass m, weight of the body is mg. And the breadth is B, height is H. And we know that weight of the body will be mg, normal reaction will be n. And it is placed on a rough surface, means friction will be in this direction. Because I am applying the force towards the right. So friction will be towards left, right? So as you are giving the force in this direction, initially the center of mass located at the center, it shift to a little. It shift by a distance of A. How to find that shift? That means force into displacement, F into H. That should be equal to M into G into A. It means we are using the force principle. F into H equals MG into A. Therefore, A equal FH by MG. So, means that to cancel this effect, as we are giving the force in this direction, the center of mass shifts by a distance of A. According to this equation, I understood that A, as A increases, F also increases. Or F increases, A increases. If you are giving more force, shift will be more towards the right. As H increases, also A got increased. You take the case of limiting case. Till what time it will oppose it? It means limiting case, F should be equal to mu n. N should be equal to mg, that is mu mg. So we are taking the case FH is equal to mg into B by 2. That means mu, we can write it as mu is equal to, if you are substituting the value of mu as mu mg is equal to mu mg h is equal to mg into b by 2. I get an equation mu equal b by 2h. So this is your coefficient of friction you got. B, mu equal b by 2h. This question directly also it came for the exam. Mu equal b by 2h. Then we take some condition. If mu value is lesser than b by 2h, the block will slide. If mu value is greater than b by 2h, the block will tilt. So in that form, they can ask the toppling questions. So first, we are using that force principle, that force into displacement principle. I found how much it is getting shifted. The last and the very, very important situation of this chapter is equilibrium. Let this be a body and we are giving some coplanar parallel forces. So here the coplanar parallel forces are, let this be a body, two forces are acting up, that is P and Q, and three forces are acting down, R, W and S. If the body is under equilibrium, under translational equilibrium, P plus Q, upward force should be equal to downward force. P plus Q equal R plus S plus W. So you should remember this. The body is at equilibrium, net force should be zero. That means upward force should be equal to downward force. If the body is under rotatory equilibrium, that is a very important case, you have to take this force into the distance from the center. That means P into P and this Q into Q, that should be equal to R into R, W into W and S into S. So we get an equation PP plus QQ is equal to RR plus SS plus WW. This is the equation for rotatory equilibrium. So equilibrium questions are very, very important in this chapter. These toppling questions are important. And the kinetic energy related questions, kinetic energy of the body. And this question what I told is when a body is rolling, what is the velocity at the top will be 2V we are getting. And what is the rotational kinetic energy equation. And V is equal to R omega, A equal to R alpha questions. And how to change our equation. If you know this, most of the equations of this chapter get covered. Okay, and how in the vector form, and this question also very, very important in this chapter. That means how the velocity, acceleration and time is later for a body moving in an inclined plane. Very, very important question is this one, removal. When a body is removing, a small portion is removing, what happened for the center of mass? Then the moment of inertia of the different bodies, and see in these all questions, moment of inertia of the different bodies when we are doing, you have to remember about the radius of gyration, how we are taking radius of gyration. I told in the simple form, the radius of gyration is nothing but you equate that moment of inertia to mk square. Then parallel axis, perpendicular axis theorem and moment of inertia of the removed bodies. Center of mass of the few bodies, you remember. And the general equation of center of mass is m1 x1 plus m2 x2. Plus etc. up to mn xn by m1 plus m2 plus etc. up to mn. If you do these all questions or these all equation, you can solve any questions of system of particles. Thank you.